Pretty cool, huh? We're at the Fernbank Planetarium in Atlanta, surrounded by stars, galaxies, and planets. The search to understand the universe is one of the greatest of all pursuits. In this segment of Physics in Motion, we're going to see what the wavelengths of the color spectrum can tell us about, well, almost anything, including celestial bodies. It's called spectral composition, which is patterns of dark lines in the color spectrum of an object, whether it's a flower or a star. It can help us discover what stars are made of, or find out how fast a planet or asteroid is moving away or toward us. On Earth, nature uses spectral composition in processes like photosynthesis in plants. Every single element in the periodic table has a special spectral pattern. They're unique, like a fingerprint. Here's the one for hydrogen. No other element has that pattern, so when you see it, you know that hydrogen is present. The theory behind the color lines is that they are created when atoms are exposed to light, and some of the light is absorbed by electrons. Some elements have a simple pattern, but the more electrons an atom has, the more complicated the fingerprint of their color spectrum can be, like this one of nitrogen. And when atoms bond together to form molecules, it's even more complex. It's that pattern of absorption and reflection that gives us the infinite array of color that we use to make the dyes in textiles and the pigments in art that add so much color to our lives. Every element has two different kinds of color spectra. One is called the absorption spectrum, which is created when light strikes an atom and its electrons move from lower to higher energy levels. In this image of the hydrogen absorption spectrum, you can see some wavelengths of light are absorbed by the electrons, leaving black lines in the spectrum. The other kind of spectrum is the emission spectrum. Here's what hydrogen's emission spectrum looks like. Emission spectra are created when electrons fall back to lower energy levels and release photons or packets of light. This occurs when electrons are energized either by high temperatures or electric current. In the two spectra, see how the black lines of the absorption spectrum correspond to the color bands of the emission spectrum? It's the same wavelength of light that is absorbed or emitted. I told you that plants make good use of spectral composition too. Here's how it works. There are various kinds of chlorophyll molecules in plants, but all have magnesium in one end of the molecule that collects the sun's energy as photons of light. It's the magnesium, the only metal in chlorophyll, that triggers the photosynthesis that makes food for the plants. But there's something else awesome going on too. There are so many chlorophyll molecules on Earth that the sunlight that strikes the Earth and then reflects from it to the moon includes the green of plant life, that is, the spectral composition of chlorophyll. That reflected light is called Earthshine. You see it in the dark silhouette of the rest of the moon when it's in the crescent or quarter stage. Scientists use this particular spectral pattern in two ways. One, to help them understand what's happening on Earth in terms of potentially harmful changes in Earth's vegetation. And two, they look for the same kind of spectral pattern on other planets in the search for extraterrestrial plant life. So spectral composition may help us find other life in the universe. Spectral lines also help scientists analyze what celestial bodies, like galaxies, stars, or planets, are made of. These are the spectral lines of our own sun. There are an incredible number of them in this image, from all the different elements in the sun, each with their own spectral composition. And here's a mystery. There are some spectral lines that scientists don't recognize. There's something else happening in the sun that does not allow those wavelengths to be emitted, but we don't know what it is. Some brilliant scientist, maybe even you, could be on the team that discovers the answer. As we said at the top of this segment, the colors of the spectrum also help scientists measure how fast a star is moving away or toward us, using shifts in where the spectral lines appear as the objects race through the universe. When a light source moves away from us, the spectral pattern of the wavelengths it emits move toward the red end of the spectrum, and that's called redshift. The further the spectral lines are shifted to the red end, the faster the object is moving away from us, and the further away it is from us. When the lines shift toward the blue, what do you think is happening? Right, the star or asteroid or even a galaxy is moving toward us. Here's an image comparing redshift, blue shift, and unshifted wavelengths. You can see how the line patterns have moved. It's similar to what we call the Doppler effect in sound, how pitch changes as the wave moves toward or away from us. Just like this siren. To understand more about the nature of spectral composition, we have to go from the macro level of the infinite universe all the way down to the subatomic level, to the smallest bits of matter that have been detected. That's what quantum mechanics, or quantum theory, studies. Quanta is another word for packets, separate bits of energy. And in a moment, you'll see why that's important. Quantum mechanics deal with very cool stuff, from black holes and neutron stars to parallel universes and time travel. From quantum theory, we know that the measurements are discrete, which means separate and disconnected. They're not continuous, like a graph of a math function or the threads of a screw. Instead, there are jumps between levels, like steps on a staircase. At an atomic level, there are only packets, or quanta, that govern how energy and matter behave, which means that electrons can only be at whole number addresses, like 1, 2, or 3. They cannot ever exist part way between two whole numbers. There is no 1.35 level, for example. Here's how we diagram those quantum levels into chemical shells, which are the numbers 1, 2, 3, and the orbitals within those shells are s, p, and d. Let's look at that more closely. Energy increases from the bottom of the diagram to the top. The numbers refer to the electron shells that surround the atom's nucleus. The 4 indicates the fourth shell, for instance, which is a higher energy shell than the 1, or first shell. The lowest level is called the ground state. As we go to a higher shell, the distance between the shells gets smaller, so the electron jumps a bigger distance from shell 1s to 2s than from, say, 4s to 5s. That means that as we move from ground state to higher energy states, those higher energy addresses become closer and closer. When an atom absorbs a high energy photon, electrons will jump to a higher energy level. When an atom absorbs a lower energy photon, it will not jump as far. Conversely, when an electron falls from a higher energy level to a lower one, the farther it falls, the more energy is released. We've covered a lot of territory in this segment on spectral composition, from the far reaches of space to the inner circles of atoms. Quite a journey. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion. See you next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.